If you leave me now, Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mighty God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. We worship you and glorify your wonderful name. Your name is to be exalted above every name. Hallelujah. There's no other name given under heaven among men whereby we must be saved, but in the name of Jesus. So right now, Lord, we humbly lift up your name and praise you and glorify you and giving you thanks and giving you glory for all that is due unto your wonderful name. Bless, lead, and direct us, and keep us, O God. Guide us by thine eye. Continue to bless us and give us, hallelujah, the victory and understanding to your word. We give you praise and we give you glory. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you, my brethren. God bless every one of you. And welcome to our teleconference service. And we just want to glorify the God of our salvation. And the God, hallelujah, who has brought us from a mighty long way. When we think back where we are coming from, we want to give God praise, we want to give God glory, and we want to glorify the name of Jesus. Bless you, my dear sister Rose, and others are on there. God bless you. We are just happy to be in the presence of the Lord to glorify him and to lift him up and to give him praise, because he's worthy. He's worthy of all our praises. Hallelujah. And today I just want to go choose a scripture, and you know, it was on my heart to talk today to you, my brethren, about the leaders and the rulers of this world. Hallelujah. And I'm going to read a scripture taken from 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 1 to 22. And let us listen attentively as we look into the Word of God and see the power of the Word of God and what it means to us. So our scriptures, 1 Samuel chapter 8, and I'm going to read. And our topic is the leaders and the rulers of this world. The leaders and the rulers of this world. And we start with saying now, how did all this started? How this all this started pertaining to the people of God, pertaining to the children of God, the children that is called by the name of our Lord Jesus, the people of God, the true people of God, the descendant of Abraham, those people that God called out of Egypt, took out of Egypt. And I'm going to read from verse Samuel. Now, this is the time when I'm going to read the scripture and then we talk about it. So 1 Samuel 18 and verse 1. I'm going to read from verse 1 to verse 22 and you will see where I'm coming from. It says, 1 Samuel 18, 1 to 22. It says, it came to pass that when Samuel was old, that he made him his son judges over Israel. And the name of the firstborn was Joel, and the name of the second was Abiah, and they were judges in Beer-sheba. And the sons walked not in the way of the Lord, but turned aside to lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgment, that all the elders and the Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel from Ramah and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy son walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel, what they said, and gave to give us a king. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken to the voice of the people in all they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, so that I should not reign over them according to all the works which they have done since the day I brought them out of Egypt, even unto this day. Wherefore they have hearkened unto me and serve other gods. So do they also unto thee. Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit, yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of king that shall reign over them. And Samuel told the words of the Lord unto the people that asked him for a king, and he said, this is the manner of the king that shall rule over you. He shall take your sons and appoint them for himself, for his chariots, to be his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariot, and he shall appoint him captain over thousands and over fifties, and he shall set them to ear to the ground, and to reap the harvest, and to make instruments of war, instruments of his chariots. And he shall take your daughters and your to be confectionaries, and to be cooks and bakers, and he will take your field and your vineyard, olive oil, and even the best of them, and give them to thy servant, and take the tenth of thy seed to their vineyard. And nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, nay, but we shall have a king to rule over us, that we may be like other nations, and our king may judge us and go before us and fight our battles. And Samuel heard the words of the people and rehearsed them in the ears of the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice, their voice, and make them king. And Samuel said unto the men of Israel, go ye every man unto his city. Amen. God bless the reading of his word. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord Jesus. So we want to talk about leaders and rulers of this world. Now in the days of Samuel, we know about Samuel, how Samuel came into being, that his mother pleaded to the Lord because she could not bear a child, and she pleaded to the Lord, and the Lord gave her a child, and she gave that child back to the Lord. She said, if the Lord give her a child, she will give that child back to the Lord. So as God answered her prayer and gave her a child, she gave back Samuel to God. Amen. And that's why every mother should do, give their children back to the Lord. But that's what his mother did. And so God's hands was upon Samuel from he was a child. And God guided Samuel and leaded Samuel and caused Samuel to be judge over his people. And while Samuel was judging the people, it was good. Everything was good because he, Samuel, took the commandment from the Lord and was directed by God in everything he did. And God was pleased. And Israel was at peace. But, you know, sometimes we as human, we are never satisfied with what we have. We always seem to want more and better. And maybe there's nothing wrong with it within some context. But when things are going well, we should thank God for it. And the children of Israel was not happy because Samuel made his son judges over Israel, and his son began to do turn aside from the Lord and started to go after lucre, which is money and bribes and things like that. So the children of Israel were not happy with what was coming. So they said, we want a king. But sometimes it's not everything that we want is good for us. It's not everything. Because God was leading the children of Israel. God was guiding them, even as he took them out of the land of Egypt and guided them through the wilderness all 40 years. And they had everything they wanted. God provided for them those 40 years in the wilderness. And we see because they rebelled against God, and they, you know, people are so, as human, we are so self-willed. We want to have things our way. It has to be our way. And this is what happened when the children of Israel came out of Egypt. They wanted to have everything their way. And when they want it, how they want it. And we see many times it displeased God. How they grieve God. Because of all God did for them. Took them out of bondage. Out of the bondage of Egypt. Of out under the hand of their taskmaster, and lead them through even the Red Sea to a promised land, and they were not satisfied. So this time they wanted their own king. And they cried unto Samuel, and Samuel said to God, the people cried, they want their own king. Sometimes it's not everything that we want is good for us, as I've said before. And God said, yes, you know, we always say the voice of the people is the voice of God. Because God wants to give us what we want, and he wants to guide us in our decision. But if we do not accept his guidance, then he has left us to our own. God never forced anyone to do anything. And if we think about even in the Garden of Eden, when God said to Adam, of all the fruits, the trees that in the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the fruit, the tree that is in the midst of the garden, thou shalt not eat it. So God always warned us. And in this instant, we see that God say, yes, okay, give them what they want. They want a king, give them a king. But protest to them. In other words, show them what this king that they're asking for is going to do for them. Just show them the other side of the coin. Sometimes we just look at one side of the coin. We don't look at the other side of the coin. But God said to Samuel, show them the other side. If you want a king, are you prepared for what this king will do to you? And Samuel said, yes. And he said, and Samuel said this word unto the people that asked for a king. This is the manner. This is the way the king shall rule over you. Imagine, this is how the king that you want is going to rule over you. He will take your sons and appoint them for himself and his chariots. And his horsemen, and some shall run before his chariot. So when we ask things out of the will of God, it's not always better for us. And in most all the time, it's never always best for us. When Samuel was leading the children of Israel, it was led by the Spirit of God. God spoke to Samuel. Samuel spoke to the people. God spoke to Samuel. Samuel spoke to the people. But they wanted their own king. And this is what the king was going to do to them. And he said, "And he shall appoint you captain over 1,000 and captain over 50s, and set you them to the ear to the ground, and reap his harvest, and make them instruments of war." So God is not want us to be instruments of war. But if we want a king, then the king may make us instruments of war, and they may rule us in a way that may be grievous to us. And so we see that as he has spoken, so it was, that you say he shall take your field and your vineyard. So when we want to turn away from God and turn to man, this is what it's boiling down to, is that the people of children of Israel wanted to turn away from God as their leader, as their ruler, and turn to man as their leader and their ruler. And this is the consequence of turning away from God. And God said to Samuel, "These people, they have not rejected you," because Samuel was leader, but they rejected him and they wanted their own king. God said to Samuel, "These people have not rejected you, they have rejected me. So give them a king." And as we see that as they had their king, everything that Samuel said to them came to pass. And God said unto Samuel to anoint Saul. And this 1 Samuel 15, God anointed Saul to be king. And 1 Samuel 16, Samuel also said unto Saul, "The Lord has sent me to anoint thee king over Israel." Well, Saul became king at the age of 30, and he was king for about 22 years. And when Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint the king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, thou hearken thou to the voice of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, I remember that which the Amalek did to Israel when they laid wait for him on the way when they came out of Egypt. Now go and smite the Amalek, and destroy utterly all they have, and spare them not, and slay both man and woman, infant, suckling, ox, sheep, and ass." So here was the first king of Israel. Here comes Saul. And Samuel gave him a command from God. Said, "Remember those people, the Amalekites, when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, and they laid wait, and they gave Israel a hard time," put in our language, a hard time. And I remember, if you remember the story about how the Amalek fight against Israel when they came out of Egypt, and it came down to the point that when Moses hold his hand up, Israel prevailed. But his hand grew tired, and when his hand grew tired, then the Amalek prevailed. And then came Joshua and Caleb to hold up his hand. And while they hold up Moses' hand, Israel prevailed. But they gave Israel a hard time, and God remember. You know something? Anything that happened to us, God remembers. God says, "I remember the Amalek, what they did to the children of Israel. Now, Saul, you go and destroy them utterly, utterly." This is a command. Utterly from you, you know, utterly. And spared not. I'm sorry, somebody made an interference. I need to mute someone. They always make interference. I'm sorry. Someone need to mute their phone, please. I'm going to have to mute someone's phone who's making some interference. Good. I'm sorry, let me continue. So God said to Samuel, tell Saul, destroy the Amalekite, because I remember what they did. So the Bible says that Saul gathered the people together and numbered them to Telem, 200,000 footmen and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came, that was 2,000 footmen and 10,000 men, so that 12,000. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay wait in the valley. And Saul said unto the Kenites, go depart, go, get down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. For he showed kindness to the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt. So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. Amalekites. And Saul smote the Amalekites. Can you mute your mic, please? I'm going to have to mute another one. Let me mute you, sorry. And there's another one. Sorry. Yeah. There's number 7352. I think I muted them.
Yeah,
they got kids. I think I muted them. Thank you. Yes, so Saul gave this commandment. So Samuel gave this commandment to Saul. And it says it came to pass. And he took Gilgal, the king of Amalekite, alive. So God told Saul, told Samuel to tell Saul to destroy the Amalekites. And Saul decided that he would destroy them, but the king of the Amalek to save a life. When God says something, we have to obey the word of God. He said, utterly destroy them at the edge of the sword and stall spear the king. So this is what man does. When God give us as man a commandment, we tend to want to do our own thing, and that is not good. When we are led by God, we are controlled by the Spirit of God. Everything runs beautiful, everything run in harmony. But that's why the Bible said we cannot put our trust in man. And so Saul, right away, he failed God because he disobeyed the Lord. And he speared the king. And not only this king, he speared the best of the sheep and the oxen and the fatlings and the lambs and all that was good. And God was not pleased. Because, you know, God, in everything, you must have discipline, you must have principle. And God's principle is obedience to his word. And he utterly destroyed them not. And then the word of the Lord came unto Samuel, and saying, it repented me that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me, and not performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel, and he cried unto the Lord all night. You know, in everything with God depends our life with God, our peace with God, our hope with God is depending on our obedience to his word. And Saul disobeyed the word of God. And then the Lord said unto Samuel, how long will he mourn? Because Samuel cried all night, because God has rejected him, because he rejected the word of God. You know, if we reject the word of God, then God will ultimately reject us. And that's what happened to Saul. He rejected God. So this is what man does. Man always calls us to go into deeper waters. And so the Lord said unto Samuel, how long will he mourn over Saul, seeing that I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill that horn with oil and go, and I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, and I will provide him a king among his son. So the thing is, God is always looking for us, looking out for us. And God always wants what is good for us. And God always is there to guide us if we let him, if we obey him, if we are guided by him. But we're talking about rulers and leaders of this world. And how the leaders of this world tend to go their own way, and their way is departing from the word of God, departing from the statute of God, departing from the commandment of God. And so we see what happened to Saul, and we see God had to reject him. And God found a man that God said after his own heart. Now, what is the difference between Saul and David, who God told Samuel to anoint the son of Jesse? The difference now between Saul and Saul was full of his own self, and he was self-willed, and he was not humble, and he was not obedient. But God saw, and he was not a man of love, because in that 22 years that Saul reigned on earth, he raised havoc and displeased God in many things. Many times he tried to kill David when he realized that the blessings of God was upon David, when he realized the anointing of God was upon David. So the devil entered into his heart. And you know, when we turn away from God and when we disobey God, you know, we have to obey something. We are made. We are not our own. So sometimes we have to make a choice who we will listen to. And there's two kingdoms. There's two voices. The voice of the Lord and the voice of the adversary. As we see in the Garden of Eden, when God told Adam not to eat the fruit, the adversary came in, the devil himself came and said to Eve, "Did God say that thou will die? Thou will not surely die." So there's two voices. And we must know the voice of God and follow the voice of God, because only the voice of God can lead us into green pastures. Only the voice of God can lead us into truth. Only the voice of God can lead us into righteousness. So we have to distinguish between the voice of God and the voice of our adversary. And we know who our adversary is. We know who he is. We are not ignorant of his devices. And same as he was in the Garden of Eden, so sometimes he comes to us and bids us to turn away from the laws of God. And Samuel said, "How long will how long can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me." So God told Samuel to anoint the son of Jesse. And he went to Jesse's house. And he saw there all Jesse's son. But there was one that God wanted. He was not, that son was out in the field. One was not even considered. Sometimes when we think of ourselves, we're not even consider of ourselves, but God consider us. David was out in the field, tending to the sheep, and Jesse brought all his sons together because he said, "God is want one of these," but God did not want them. God's eyes is upon the righteous. His eyes is upon the humble. His eyes is upon the makers of peace. His eyes upon the children who have the love of God in their heart. And so he knew David for what he was. And how compassionate. David was a man of compassion. Sometimes we see leaders have, you know, we've seen them, so many of them have passed through. Have no compassion. Have no care. Have no love. This is man. And sometimes we find that, you know, they lead the world astray. They lead their people astray because they do not have the love They do not care. You know, the Bible says a good shepherd cared for his sheep and even lay his life down for his sheep, which is Jesus. Jesus is the good shepherd. And so in these days when there's so many voices calling, we are to hear, we are to know, and we are to acknowledge, and we are to obey the voice of Jesus. Songwriter says it is sweeter than all. Jesus' voice is sweeter than all the voices. So we are in a time now when we see all the rulers and the leaders of this world coming together, whether they be president, prime minister, whatever they're called, they come together in oneness. You know, and I say, when I see these things happen, I know the time is short. Because they look like they're all in one, getting together. Because, you know, as I said, the voice of the people is the voice of God. We see people are demonstrating in these days about this big V that they want to give everybody. But we see people are demonstrating. People say they want their freedom. And then you feel the ears of the leaders, the ears of the rulers of this world is just not listening, not caring. You know? In Kings, there was a king named Rehoboam. And, when he was to become king, the children of Israel said unto him, your fathers made our yoke heavy, you know, and we will serve you if you make our yoke lighter. And this king, Rehoboam, he said to counsel of the older men in his council, and the older man says, it is good that you deal nice well with these people. And he took counsel from the young men, and the young man says, make their yoke hard. And he took the counsel of the young men. And when he spoke to the people, he said, my father make your yoke heavy, but I will add to your yoke. My father also chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scorpion. Now this is why the Bible says, put not your trust in man. Because a leader, a ruler, a king should be listening to the voice of the people. And what we see today is what was going on years ago, that kings were not listening to the people. They were doing what they like dictator, like even now what we see now, the whole world, like every ruler has become like a dictator and telling people, you have to do this, you have to do that. You have to do this or you won't be able to work. You have to do this or you won't be able to travel. You have to do this or you won't be able to go where you want to go. You're restricted. This is what man does. And so we have to realize that God, man has got a mandate, and man's mandate is not compatible to the mandate of God. God wanted us to be free. God wanted us to be in health. The Bible says, I would that you be in health even as your soul prospers. God wants us to be happy and free, and God wants us to have peace and live in the love of God. But the way man has turned things upside down, inside out, and they turn the left to the right and the right to the left, the up to the down and the down to the up, and we see nothing but confusion. And then we will realize that we cannot put trust in man, we cannot put trust in the system, but we have to look to God. And God says, come unto me, all ye that are weary and heavy burdened. So even though man has got their mandate of what they want the world to be, it is not what God wants for us. God said, Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly. That's why Jesus died, that we may have life and more abundantly, that we may have peace. And sometimes we are rejecting the peacemaker. We are rejecting the King of the Prince of Peace. We are rejecting the Lord of Lords. We are rejecting the light of the world. We are rejecting the water of life. We are rejecting everything that is good when we reject Jesus. He is all the world. He is all the world to us. Without Jesus, the Bible says, if in this life only we have hope, we would be men most miserable. If Jesus did not raise from the dead, if he did not come and died and shed his blood for us, if he did not shed his blood for us, where would we be today? What would we be today? And we would have no hope. But we have hope now because of his blood. Because his birth, his death, and his resurrection has given us hope. So we can be joyful. And the Bible says, hope maketh not ashamed. And so we can put our trust in God and let him lead us and guide us. You know, God loved David because David was one who took, he was one king that took counsel from God. These kings, these rulers today, they just do what they like. They do not consult God. And because they do not consult God, they are leading the world astray. The world has been led astray because not these leaders do not consult God about anything. And every man to his own way. Every man is guided by his own spirit. No one seeks to be led by God. And that's what's wrong with the world today. And if we think about it, the world is really in a bad shape. When we think about what's going on around us, and it's something that we can't avoid seeing. The perplexity of nations, the confusion of nations. People are dying, people are suffering. There's no peace. It wasn't a plan for God. It wasn't a plan, God's plan. It's not in God's plan. So this king, Rehoboam, said to the people, my father make your yoke heavy, but I will add to your yoke. My father also chasten you with whips, but I will chasten you with scorpion. How heartless. When a king say that, a ruler said that, it shows how heartless man can be. And that's why we cannot trust man. We need to look to the Lord, look to the Word of God for guidance in these times, in these troubled times. Time is short. You know, when I think about what is happening today, and I think what had happened since 2020 unto 2021, and how much of a change this world has seen. I would never have thought that I would see times like this. Perplexity. Confusion. People are so confused about what is next. What is coming next. We do not know what is coming next. But I tell you, you know, when we see these things, we must realize there's change coming. And the change may not be the better. But if we are in God, you know, that's why I love the Word of God. Jesus told his disciples of what we are seeing today. He told them. Paul wrote about it in the last days, perilous times shall come. If you are not seeing perilous times, you're spiritually blind. We are spiritually blind if we are not seeing perilous times. And it's not going to get better. Because it says, the Bible says, the evil man would wax worse and worse. And the leaders who we're looking to, we're putting our trust in, are there as the king of that king, Rehoboam, said, I will chastise you with scorpion. No, you know, if somebody chastises with scorpion, that is it. Because scorpion has a deadly poison. We should know. A scorpion has a deadly poison. If you're stung by a scorpion and you don't get aid, you will die. And so it shows what the mentality of some rulers are. Some kings, some presidents, prime ministers, whatever you want to call them, chancellor, or whatever, you know, whatever name you want to call them, governor, whatever, their mentality, their heart. Their heart is not towards the people. And wherefore the king hearken not to the people. And now we see, as now people are demonstrating about this, the big passport, the passport for the C, the V, the passport for the V. I have to speak in parables now, you know, because Jesus had to speak in parables. So when I say V, passport for the V, you must know what I'm talking about. The passport for the V. People are talking about, you have to have a V passport before you can do certain things, before you can travel, before you can go to the shop, before you can go to work. Is that part of God's commandment? Is that part of God's will? Are you going to say, okay, I need a V passport? I should be stand up, you know, so I should stand up like the three Hebrew boys, like Daniel, you know, and so many, Elijah, Elisha, and all those mighty men, they stood up for God. We have to stand up for God. It's not always what the people say. We don't have to follow the people. We need to follow the word of God. We need to stay in the word of God. We need to trust God and not man. We are living in perilous times. And the Bible tells us about the coming days when people will not be able to buy or sell unless they receive the mark, which is talked about in Revelation. I feel that we are very close to that time, because when they use this word mandatory, it is mandatory that you take that V. Or if you don't take that V, then, well, you won't be able to work. Your money may be not be yours. And sometimes we think, you know, we may have a lot of money and we think our money can save us. But the time is coming when we're moving into cashless society. And the cash that we have will be turned into a digital coin, which can be taken at any time. We are reaching a time when we don't know. Maybe now we think about everything is okay, but what happened maybe years, months to come, when everything is gone, you know, we have to think about those things. And this is not meant to scare anyone, because God told us strictly that when we see these things, be not troubled. So what I'm saying today is not to scare anyone, it's to tell us and remind us that God is there with us. And if it comes to the time when there's no food in the supermarket, we look to God and God will provide. He will provide once we are in Him. He will provide. He says, fear not. When you see these things, be not troubled. So I'm not saying these things to let anyone be worried or troubled about what may be coming. But I'm saying these things to help us to focus on Jesus. This thing is to help us to look to the Lord. Because away from the Lord, there's nothing. Away from the Lord, there's no hope. Away from Jesus, who died for us, there's no peace. There's no joy. And we are living in darkness. Jesus is the light of the world. And anyone who wants to say, oh boy, Jesus is not there. He is there. I promise you, there's a scripture that says that he that letteth will let until he's taken out of the way. And that is telling us that I'm telling you, my brother, sister, these are better days. Maybe months to come, we'll be looking these days and say, that this time was better times. Because he that let it, that means what is going on. And when we think about what's going on in the world, how so many Christians are being persecuted, how so many Christians are being killed. You know, how many Christians have to be hiding and be fear, living in fear. Because what is happening and what is coming up. You know, when we think about these things, we have to think that the Lord said he will be with us. He will go in the fire with us. He will take us through the water. He will take us through the flood. Now the scripture now, when I think about Joshua 24, from verse 14, now therefore fear the Lord. This is Joshua. Now Joshua was a very courageous son of God. And they talk about Joshua. You'll hear about Joshua. Because he was very courageous when the children of Israel went to search the land. And they saw men like, they came back and said, we are like grasshoppers, because they went to search the land and they saw giants. Sometimes when we look around us, it looks like there's some giants around us. But Joshua, Caleb, and Joshua said, we have the Lord on our side. And brethren, we must say that we have the Lord on our side. And if we have the Lord on our side, we do not need to be fearful. Amen. Now Joshua said, now therefore, Joshua 24, verse 14, now therefore, serve him in sincerity, in truth, and put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And Joshua went on to say, and if it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose he you this day whom he will serve, whether in the God of your fathers serve on the other side of the flood, or the God of the Amorites, whose land they dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That is it. And each one of us have to say, as for me. And it doesn't matter if the whole world choose to serve the God of idols and serve the God of the Amorites and, you know, other gods. As for me and my house, I will serve the Lord, and the Lord will I serve, regardless come what may. I will serve the Lord. And this is what we need, commitment. And God wants us to have such a commitment. And it says the people answered and said, God forbid that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For the Lord our God has brought us up out of the land, out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage, which did those great signs in the sight and in our sight, and preserve us all the way we went, and among all peoples throughout whom we passed, the Lord drove out from before us all the people, the Amorites, which land we dwell. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for He is God. Can you imagine how wonderful this world would be if people served God? We would not have to worry about the big C. We wouldn't have to worry about the big the V, nor the C. We wouldn't have to worry about that, because God would take care of that. But because man wants to have their own way, man wants to live their own life, man wants to make their own decision, their choices, they to choose to serve the God, the gods of the Amorites, the heathen God, who will take them nowhere but to destruction. Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's a commitment. We have a made up mind to serve God, regardless. Follow Jesus, regardless. Serve Him. And lastly, in John chapter 10, verse 7, Jesus said, and said Jesus unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter, shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. You see, regardless of what is going on around us, there's a door, and the door is Jesus. He said, I am the door. So it doesn't matter. There's so many religions these days, so many religions, but God is not talking about religions. He's talking about His people, His sheep. He said, verily, I say unto you, I am the door. All that came before me. So there was no door. There was no opening. There was no leadership. All that came before me was thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If any man enter in, he shall be saved. He shall go in and out and find pasture. You know, when like a sheep go and find pasture, is the joy of all that green. You know, and it's just beautiful. He says, the thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and destroy. When we put our trust in man, they come to kill, steal, and to destroy. But Jesus says, He says, hear what Jesus says. He says, I come that they may have life, and that they might have life more abundantly. That's why Jesus came. That's why Jesus is there. The door. He came that we may have life and life more abundantly. Which ruler? And leader of today care about us having life and more abundantly? Which ruler? You point out, if there is ever a good ruler or leader, they find some way to kill them. all the prophets. They'll kill all the prophets. You know, Elijah said, they have slain all the prophets and only I alone am left. The world don't want good people. The world don't want righteous leaders. We see so many of the African leaders who are now in the grave. And they're in the grave. African leaders. And they're in the grave because they rejected that big V. Yeah, they're rejecting it. They're in the grave now. So good leaders are not around. We have to put our trust in Jesus. Jesus said, I came that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd giveth his life for his sheep. You tell me, which good shepherd do we have now? I dare you to name me one good shepherd. And if you're on the internet, you can put it in the comment there, section there. There's a note there if you're on the internet. You tell me one good shepherd that we have, one good leader that is righteous, that cares, that would give his life. You tell me one leader today or one ruler who will give his life. Jesus says, I'm a good shepherd. A good shepherd giveth his life for his sheep. Now this is why we have to look at the difference. A good shepherd, a good leader, a good ruler, give his life for his sheep. Oh, it is for us to realize. But they said the hireling, but he is a hireling. Someone don't care. Someone without responsibility. All we have today is hireling leading us. Hireling. They were hired to lead us, to guide us. They were not the shepherd. Jesus only is a good shepherd. And so his sheep know his voice. And whom the sheep are not, see the wolf. So the hireling, we're talking about leaders, the hireling, or someone is hired to lead. Someone is hired to lead or to rule. It's a hireling. So the hireling is not a shepherd, but the hireling who owns the sheep are not. They don't own the sheep. But they're leading the sheep. The hireling see the wolf is coming and leave the sheep and flee. And the wolf catches them and scatter the sheep. And the hireling flee because he's a hireling and care not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and I know my sheep and I am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so I know the Father. I lay down my life for the sheep. So to conclude, my brother, my sister, to conclude, my conclusion is this. My conclusion is that Jesus is the good shepherd. He is the only leader we have. He is the only ruler we have that we can trust. And so we should put our trust in him. And we should lean and trust in his word. And we should give him the praise and the thanks that is due to his name. And we should worship him. And we should have a close relationship with this man. Because he loves us with an abundance of love. Amen. He loves us as the Father, as if says, no greater love has any man than this, than that a man should lay down his life for his friend. His love for us is abundant. So my brethren, in all that is going on around us, I encourage us to look to Jesus. I encourage us to draw nearer to Him. I encourage us to lean upon Him and stand upon His promise, because they are sure, and I promise that He will never leave us nor forsake us. So we don't have to, regardless of what is going on around us, we don't have to live in fear and doubt. Just trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord at all time, ye people, and the good Lord bless you. As we come to the end of our teleconference, the Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause His face to shine upon you, and peace be with you. God bless you. Sister Rosa, can you close us in prayer, please?
Trust in you, Lord, and not to lean on their own understanding. I pray that you cover them from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. I pray that you bless and keep them as the week unfolds. I pray that they will continue to be strengthened, Lord, in their heart, and continue to trust in you and only you, Lord. Lord, I give you the thanks and the praise and the glory and honor. I pray that you bless your son that spoke the word today. I pray that you cover him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet, and I pray that no weapon formed against them shall ever prosper. I pray that no weapon formed against anyone that's on here tonight shall ever prosper. Lord, I give you thanks and praises through Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. God bless you, Sister Rose.
God bless you, Father Donald. God bless you, Sister Rose.
Brother David, God bless you too. Bless you all.